بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. القارعة، ما القارعة؟ وما أدراك ما القارعة؟ يوم يكون الناس كالفراش المبثوث، وتكون الجبال كالعهن المنفوش. فأما من ثقلت موازينه فهو في عيشة راضية، وأما من خفت موازينه فأمه هاوية. وما أدراك ما هي؟ نار حامية.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we thank him, we glorify him as much as he deserves to be glorified. We bear witness that he is the only one who deserves to be worshipped, and that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his final messenger and prophet. We ask Allah to continue to bless him and his household and the family and the companions. May Allah extend the blessings and mercy to each and every one of us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make our gathering today a blessed one. May Allah increase us in faith and righteousness. May Allah count it as one of our good deeds that we be pleased to see on the day of the resurrection. The topic we want to discuss, the status of hadith in Islam. This topic, as the president rightly mentioned, is a very fundamental one. Alhamdulillah, he has made a good preparation for us to build on. We have quoted many verses that there is no way one can say that hadith is not part of our religion. Talking about hadith is talking about shahadatu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. After ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, then we have Muhammadun Rasulullah. So this is what brings one into the fold of Islam. Hadith, to start with, we want to look at the classes of people in their attitudes to hadith. Attitude of people to hadith. So we have different classes of people. There are some who are who believe that hadith is the second authoritative reference in Islam after the Quran. That's the Quran, the next thing in Islam after the Quran is hadith. Then we have some who consider hadith corpus as doubtful traditions, like the gospels that we have with the Christians. There are some, when we read very well, we discover that this is the belief of some people about the hadith. Whether some of them are Muslims, they call themselves Muslims, while we have those who are not Muslims. Then there are those who do not know what hadith means. There are some people like that. They have heard about the word hadith, but we don't actually know what it means. Then there are those who are skeptical and confused about hadith because of controversy of scholarship about the authenticity or otherwise of certain ahadith. Sometimes you hear the scholars say this hadith is authentic. Sometimes you may hear that they say it's not authentic. Sometimes in some matters in Islam, you hear that this is how you are going to do it. Another person will come and say, no, it is the other way around. Some people become skeptical and confused. Then there are those who have knowledge of the science of hadith, and when they quote hadith, they only quote what is authentic. There are some like this. And we have some others who are not aware of anything known as the science of hadith. Anything that is attributed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is considered to be hadith. In fact, I heard a person saying one day that, how can you say the hadith of the Prophet is da'if? How can the Prophet say something and you will say this hadith is da'if? The Prophet says something and you say it is weak. How can you say that? You know, we show that the person does not really understand this concept of the science of hadith. Then we have those who reject all hadith. They don't believe in hadith at all. We have some who claim to be Muslims, and there are some who are not Muslims. They don't believe in hadith. To them, it's Quran. Some of them are known as Quraniyun, the Quranists. Then in the north, they are often called Kalakato. And in Lagos State here, we have the Quraishuddin. So they don't believe in the hadith. They reject all hadith. Then we have some who reject some parts of hadith, not all. But this rejection is based on their whims, on their desire, or logic. There are some people like that. You have heard about many of them. They will reject some hadith, they will take some hadith. Then what's the right attitude towards hadith? What should be the right attitude towards it? What's the importance of hadith? What gives hadith authority in Islam? What's the origin of hadith? Then this is what we are going to address today, inshallah. Then, what is hadith? What is hadith? If you are to define what hadith is an Arabic word. Since it's an Arabic word, we can define it literally and technically. Literally, in Arabic, when they say something is hadith, like you have Asrul Hadith, the modern era. Something hadith, it means something that is a new, recent, or a piece of information, intelligence, an announcement, a matter, something talked of, or something that is narrated. That is hadith. In the Quran and hadith, the word hadith appears in many places. In the Quran, for example, the word hadith appears about 26 times. About 26 times, you find the word hadith. And the way it has been used in the Quran is like this. When Allah says, as the hadith of Abraham's noble girls come to you, who will read that one in Arabic? Let somebody read that one in Arabic. That first verse. Hal hataka hadithu Doif Ibrahim al Mukramin. Hal hataka hadithu Doif Ibrahim al Mukramin. As the hadith of Abraham's noble girls come to you. Here, what does the hadith mean? Huh? Information. Report. Story. Then look at the other verse. Allah says, let them produce a hadith like this if they are truthful. Somebody can bring this in Arabic. فَلْيَأْتُوا بِحَدِيثٍ مِثْلِهِ إِنْ كَانُوا صَدِقِينَ. What does hadith mean here? فَلْيَأْتُوا بِحَدِيثٍ مِثْلِهِ إِنْ كَانُوا صَدِقِينَ. They should produce a hadith like this. Which means that the Quran is the hadith in that verse. So Allah refers to the Quran itself as hadith. Then another place Allah says, Allah has sent down the best hadith, a book that is similar in 2 ways. The skins of those who reference their Lord shiver from it. Then their skins and their hearts soften up to the remembrance of Allah. Such is Allah's guidance. To the end of the verse. Allahu nazzala ahsan al-hadithi kitaban mutashabiha. Hadith here refers to what? Huh? What is hadith in this verse? The Quran itself. Allah says he has sent down the best hadith. So in this verse, hadith means the Quran. Then another one says, as the hadith come to you of the soldiers, who are these soldiers? What's the Arabic of this? Al-hataka hadithul junood. Al-hataka hadithul junood. Fir'aun wa Thamud. So here it also means story. Then we have, as the hadith come to you of that which will overwhelm. Al-hataka hadithul ghashiyah. Then many other verses like this. So from these, we can say that the possible meanings of the word hadith are narrations, sayings, words, speech, opinion, statement, utterance, discourse, accounts, and tale. But technically, that's where we are going. What does the hadith mean in Islam? Hadith means reports of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, action, tacit approval, manners, physical characteristics, or biographical data. In other words, in other words, Hadith is the report of Sunnah. Hadith is the report of Sunnah. What is Sunnah? Sunnah, according to scholars of Hadith, means established way of life of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The life, the way of life of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is his sayings, practices, and approvers, which are of religious bearing. So when we are talking about Sunnah, Sunnah means what? The sayings, the practices, and the approvers of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, the reports of those sayings, the reports of those practices, the reports of those approvers is known as Hadith. So, that's why you cannot hear anybody saying, this Sunnah is weak, this Sunnatun Da'ifa, Sunnatun Sahiha. No, you can only hear Hadithun Sahih, Hadithun Da'if. That is, this report from the Prophet is weak, it's not authentically reported. It's the report we'll be talking about. But for the Sunnah, it's already established. There won't be any doubt about it. Proofs of authority of Hadith. In Islam, does Hadith have authority? What are the proofs that we must follow Hadith in Islam? The President has quoted many verses regarding this. One, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, that's Quran chapter 16, verse 44. بالبينات والزبر وأنزلنا إليك الذكر لتبين للناس ما نزل إليهم ولعلهم يتذكرون. Meaning, we sent them, that is the prophets, with clear proofs and writings, and we have revealed unto you, who is that you there? Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The reminder, that is the Quran. So that you may explain to people that which has been revealed for them, and that they may reflect. Look at how Allah ends the verse. وَلَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. Now let's reflect. Because Allah says, so that they may reflect. Allah says, and we have revealed unto you the reminder. That is the Quran. Revealed unto whom? Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Why? So that you may explain to people that which has been revealed for them. He says, it has been revealed to you. And here, he also says, it has been revealed for them. Which means that the Quran was revealed directly to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Indirectly, it is meant for you. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is to do two things. The first one is the revelation given to him. He has to convey it to whom? To people. Then, not only to convey, but also to do what? To explain. Remember, the Arabs, particularly those that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam lived in their midst, they were all Arabs. And they were people renowned with eloquence. They were very eloquent, these people. That's what distinguished this generation of mankind. Then Allah yet says, you have to explain to them. He has to explain to them, which means that there are certain things that they, as humans, may not be able to appreciate from the message of the Quran. They need somebody to explain. If the person to explain to them can just acquire knowledge and explain, then Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam won't be special in this order of Allah to explain to them. It means that there must be some knowledge that should be vouchsafed to him from on high. Which means that the interpretation of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam should also be a revelation. Because if it's something that everybody can just explain, then Allah would not have said, in order for you to explain to them. So the Prophet is to do two things. The first one is to convey the revelation of the Quran. The second is to interpret that Quran. So the Quran, we know it. The interpretation of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where is it? Little bayina linnas. For you to explain for people. How did the Prophet explain the Quran? He explained it in three ways. The first one is through his, I want you to answer it, through his sayings. The second way he explained the Quran is through his actions. And the third way he explained the Quran is through his approvers and disapprovers. If the Prophet ﷺ was sent to mankind, those explanations would not end at the first generation of mankind, those who saw him. The explanation must be conveyed down to generations to come till the last day. This shows that the hadith must be preserved. The explanation of the Quran, the prophetic explanation of the Quran, must be preserved just as the Quran itself will be preserved. Because Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not only sent to those who lived during his time. He's a prophet forever. La nabiyya ba'da. There will be no new prophet after him. Then, we have established that Sunnah is a revelation. Another proof to show that Sunnah is a revelation is that Allah says here, هُوَ الَّذِي بَعَثَ فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ يَتْلُوَ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ وَإِنْ كَانُوا مِنْ قَبْلَ فِي ضَلَالٍ مُّبِينٍ. Meaning, that's Quran chapter 62 verse 2. Let's take note of all these references. Because we are to hear and to convey the message. Allah says, it is he who has sent amongst the unlettered a messenger from among themselves to rehearse to them his signs, ayati, that this is revelations, to purify them, and to teach them the scripture, the kitab, and hikmah, although they had been before in manifest error. Look at the verse again. The Quran is not like the word of any mortal. Whenever we are reading it, we have to reflect deeply. We are going to discover a lot of things. That's something unique about the Quran. Any verse you come across, don't just read it as if you are reading the word of a mortal. Reflect. You will understand beyond what you can merely understand if you reflect. Allah says, he has sent down among the unlettered a messenger from among themselves. So he asked to them his signs. Yetilu alayhim ayati. That's one of the reasons. Why is the key him? To purify them. Take care. And to teach them. What is it to teach them? The Quran, the Kitab, and Hikmah. How many things did the prophets teach the Ummah? How many things? How many things did the prophets teach the Ummah? Two. The first one is Kitab, which is Quran. The second one is Hikmah. What is Hikmah? What is Hikmah? Sunnah. That's the explanation of the prophet. So the prophet was teaching the Ummah two things, not only one thing. So the Sunnah is the teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is his sayings, his actions, and his approvers. Then let's see another verse, Quran chapter 4, verse 113. Allah says, وَلَوْلَا فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكَ وَرَحْمَتُهُ لَهَمَّتْ طَائِفَةٌ مِّنْهُمْ أَن يُضِلُّوكَ وَمَا يُضِلُّونَ إِلَّا أَنفُسَهُمْ وَمَا يَضُرُّونَكَ مِنْ شَيْءٍ وَأَنزَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَأَنزَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَعَلَّمَكَ مَا لَمْ تَكُنْ تَعْلَمُ وَكَانَ فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكَ عَظِيمًا. Look at the meaning. But for the grace of Allah to you and His mercy, a party of them would have certainly plotted to lead you astray. But in fact, they will only lead their own souls astray. And to you, they can do no harm in the least. For Allah has sent down to you the book and the hikmah. How many things has Allah sent down to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Two things. You know, we came across the roles of the Prophet. His role, two roles. To convey the revelation and to explain the revelation. Then his teachings, he taught how many things? Two things. The Kitab and the Sunnah. We have seen that from the Quran. Then Allah says he sends to him how many things? Two things. The first one is the book. The second one is the hikmah. How can you not reject hadith? When Allah says he sends down two things to the prophet, to the al-wahyu al-matlum. And the other one is al-wahyu ghayru matlum. a revelation that is recited, and the other one is a revelation that is not recited. The first one that is recited is the Quran. We recite in our Salah. The second one that is not recited is the Sunnah, which is recorded in Hadith. That one is not recited. So which means that the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ was also inspiration from Allah, is a revelation. Two things. So you can't go with one and leave the other. When you do that, your case will be as those that Allah says, أَفَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِبَعْدِ الْكِتَابِ وَتَكْفُرُونَ بِبَعْدِ. Do you believe in a part of the book and you disbelieve in the other parts? This is what Allah says. Then, is it only a part of the book that you believe in and you reject the rest? But what is the reward for those among you who behave like this? But disgrace in this life, and on the day of judgment, they shall be consigned to the most grievous penalty. For Allah is not unmindful of what you do. Anyone who take a part of the Quran and leave the rest, this is what Allah says about him. Disgrace here and disgrace hereafter. When you believe in the Quran and you don't believe in the Sunnah, in the Hadith, then this verse applies to you. Then Allah Azza wa Jalla says, Inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidhun. Quran 15 verse 9. Allah says, we have without doubt sent down the dhikr, the reminder, and we will assuredly guard it. Assuredly we are going to guide it. Allah says, I send down the Quran and he must guide it. He only mentions al-dhikr here. If Allah has appointed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as the divine authority to explain the Quran, Allah knows that the Quran cannot be handled alone except with some human explanation. But that human must be a human that is inspired. That's the Prophet. Allah knows that the Quran cannot be approached alone without a human like you that will explain it in the sayings and actions so that you will be able to emulate him. So Allah knows that the Quran will not be sufficient for us without being explained by human being like us, a person we can take as a role model. If the Quran is known to be preserved and protected by Allah, Allah would not leave out the Sunnah, which is meant to explain the Quran. So this verse, by extension, applies to the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidhun. We indeed send down the reminder and we are going to protect it. Then Allah says in Quran chapter 33 verse 21, that's Surah Al-Ahzab, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرُجُّ اللَّهَ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرِ وَذَكَرَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. Look at the meaning and let's reflect. You have indeed in the Messenger of Allah a beautiful pattern of conduct to follow for anyone whose hope is in Allah on the final day. If your hope is in Allah and you hope for bliss, the bliss of hereafter, you have to follow the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Wadhakar Allah kathira. Allah recommends the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and validates his sayings and conduct. Therefore, whoever hopes to meet Allah in safety and desires the bliss of the next life must take him as the model. This verse, is it meant for the companions alone or is meant for everybody? Is it meant for the companions of the Prophet alone or for all the Muslims? For all the Muslims. If the Sunnah, if the examples of the Prophet would not be preserved, how would Allah instruct us in the Quran to emulate him? It means that Allah knows definitely that the Sunnah of the Prophet will never be lost. This is why the verse is there in the Quran that you have in the Messenger of Allah the best example to follow. But we never saw him. And Allah says we should emulate him. The Quran gets to us, but the Prophet was a martyr. He is to die, and he died. If the verse does not enjoy perpetuity, is not something to be applied by those who should come after the demise of the Prophet, then the verse became redundant the day the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam died, which is not the case. Then another verse of the Quran Allah Azza wa Jalla says, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu atihu Allah wa atihu Rasul wa ulil amri minkum. O you who believe, obey Allah and obey the messenger of Allah and the people of authority amongst you. Fa in tanaza'tum fi shay'in. If you define anything amongst yourselves, farudduhu ila Allah wa Rasul. Refer it to Allah and his messenger. Look at the repetition of the messenger. Obey Allah, obey the messenger and those who are charged with authority. But if you define anything, you only refer it to Allah and to the messenger alone. When there is difference amongst you, not to the people of authority again. That is, you have to look, if you want to refer our disputes to Allah, where do we go? The Quran. If you want to refer our dispute to the Prophet, when he was alive, we go to him. After his demise, we go to where? Sunnah. You go to his hadith. So it means that Allah already knows that the hadith must be preserved. If it would not be preserved, Allah would not recommend that we refer our disputes to the Prophet after his demise. Then, another verse of the Quran, Quran chapter 4, verse 64 and 65. Allah says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا لِيُطَاعَ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ وَلَوْ أَنَّهُمْ إِذْ ظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ